I am Philip. I am from the Neo-Catechumenal Communities. We have just celebrated the second Sunday of Lent. And in the second Sunday of Lent, the Church always puts in front of us the Feast of the Transfiguration, where Jesus will go on top of the mountain, and there with his three disciples, he will be completely transformed into glory. His earthly flesh will be transfigured, and appearing on either side of him will be Moses and Elijah. This transfiguration is a very important feast because it shows to us the ultimate glory to which this human flesh is predestined. But to enter into this glory, we first have to pass through a particular route, a particular way. And that way is this human life with all its trials, with all its tribulations. For this reason, the Church also gives to us the first Sunday of Lent, the Gospel of the Temptations. The Gospel of the Temptation is a very important Gospel because it shows to us the life that we are leading. We have to keep one thing in mind, that Jesus Christ is a Jew, and the historicity is something which is very important. We need to understand something about the history of the people of Israel in order to understand our own faith more deeply. You see, the people of Israel, for 40 years, they have to pass through the desert. God will take them through the desert, and these 40 years are in a way encapsulated by these 40 days of Lent and these 40 days that Jesus Christ also spent in the desert. The people of Israel have been ransomed from Egypt, from the slavery of Egypt by God, who worked very powerfully in their lives with many signs, with many miracles. He opened the Red Sea for them. And then they have to start trudging through the desert. During this time, while they are in the desert, they are tempted. And these temptations that they go through, even Jesus Christ, he too has to assume these same temptations, so that he becomes one with us completely. It is very hard for us to take up, to go through the temptations. But if Christ is living inside of us, then there is the possibility for us not to fall the way in which he did not fall. That is why in the Transfiguration you will see Moses on one side and Elijah on the other side. The law and the prophets completely fulfilled in Jesus Christ. What is the first temptation that the people of Israel had? The first temptation is that they are hungry. The children are crying because there is nothing to eat. Because in the desert there is nothing. They have just sung, "Horse and rider, Lord, you are thrown into the sea." We have seen all the chariots and all the horsemen of Pharaoh drowned in the waters of the Red Sea. And they are full of joy and happiness. But just a few days later, they are confronted with another problem. And when they are confronted with this problem, their first response is, "Moses, you give us food to eat or we are going back to Egypt. At least in Egypt we had watermelons and we had garlic and we had onions." They have forgotten everything that God has done for them in Egypt to bring them out. And what is the temptation that Jesus Christ has to face? That after fasting for 40 days, he is hungry. And Satan will say to him, "If ever you go to the Judean desert, you will see that the sun is so strong that all the stones there are sun bleached. They look like they look like little buns. Looks just like bread. Little pause." And Satan will say, if you are the Son of God, if you are the Son of God, you can turn this bread, these stones into bread, just with one word." And Jesus will answer to Satan, "Man does not live on bread alone, but every word which comes from the mouth of God." What is the temptation that you and I face every day? We too are hungry for so many things. We are hungry for money, we are hungry for success, And every time we are confronted with a particular hunger, Satan, he will give to us the easy way out. Like he was offering to Jesus Christ the easy way out. You are hungry, say one word and the stones will become bread. And Satan, he shows to us, we don't have enough money, he shows us how to rob. If you are lonely, then he and bored, then he will show you how to misuse the internet. If you don't want to have a baby, he will show you how to use contraceptives. In some way or the other, Satan will always put in front of you a solution so that you can overcome the problem without having to pass through the hardship of the cross, which God has prepared. If any man wants to be my disciple, let him take up his cross and come after me. Satan knows that the way to salvation is through the cross, through the suffering. But at once he offers to us a way out of the suffering, so that we never see the glory of God in our life. How did Jesus Christ overcome the temptation? He overcame the temptation through the Word of God, because he is the Word made flesh. In the same way, my dear brothers and sisters, the church gives us gives us weapons during this time of Lent to fight against the hungers that we have, the hungers of our passion, the need to be appreciated, always to have the esteem of the other, the love of the other. And what is the weapon? The weapon is to fast. You know that the church invites us during this time to fast. Yes, of course, we can fast from food. We have to also to put our bodies through the suffering, to prove that we don't live by bread alone. But there are so many other things we can fast from. We can fast from anger. We can fast from hatred. We can fast from our jealousies. We can fast from the fact that we need to sit in front of Netflix and the television the whole day long. But this is the first temptation. Now, what is the second temptation? The second temptation is an extremely insidious temptation. That the people of Israel, they have to walk through the desert. And while they are walking through the desert, there is no water. And there in the desert, God will say to Moses to strike the rock. And Moses will strike the rock, because he will strike the rock twice. And the water will come out. But the people of Israel, they don't like this precariousness which they have to go through every day. That every day the rock has to be struck and water has to be given to them. What if one day Moses is in a bad mood and he forgets to strike the rock? Or if he is angry and he doesn't want to do it? The people of Israel don't want to be precarious. They want everything to be delivered to them cut and dried. They don't accept the history that they are not the masters of their own life. They cannot accept the fact that every day they need to convert. Because if they don't convert, perhaps God will be angry with them and not give to them the water. They will demand from Moses, we are thirsty, give us water to drink. Give us water to drink and give it now. Because if you don't give it to us now, we will stone you. We will return to Egypt. But God is a patient God. He is patient with his people. He knows that 400 years of slavery has dehumanized them completely, which is why he will always accede to their demands. Jesus Christ has a very similar temptation, the temptation of the history, not being able to accept who you are, that always you need to be dependent on somebody else. The second temptation of Jesus Christ is the temptation where, see, Satan will say to Christ, see, you are the Son of God, no? You know, I know, nobody else knows. So why don't you go on top of the temple, the pinnacle of the temple, and then when everybody has come during the time of the feast, when Jerusalem is full of people, at that time you jump off the temple, and scripture says that the Holy One, you are the Holy One, you will not dash your foot against a stone. The angels will come and they will escort you down in glory. Everybody will know that you are the Messiah. They will sing Hosanna to you, and then you can do your mission, man. Because like this kid, who, you are the son of the carpenter. Everybody knows your mother. What scandal there was during the time of your birth. And your father is Joseph, a humble fellow. You're going to say you are the son of God. Who is going to believe that? Jesus will answer to Satan, do not put the Lord your God to the test. And what is the temptation that we face every day in our life? Is the temptation of the history. I don't like the fact that I am not as intelligent as my sister. I don't like the fact that my brother is richer than me. I don't like the fact that my children, they don't study. I don't like the fact that my wife always grumbles. I don't like the fact that my husband doesn't earn enough. I don't like the fact that I am getting old and now there are pains all over in my body. I don't like the fact that I am too fat, I am too thin, I am too bald, I am too old, I am too whatever. We want to be Mother Teresa and you want to be Madhuri Dixit at the same time. You don't accept the fact that you are just an ordinary person. You want to be a superstar. But we are not going after Jesus Christ superstar. We are going after the one who finished his life on the cross. Who died like a dog on the cross. The Psalms will say, I am more of a worm than a man. We don't like to be plain. We don't like to be ordinary. We don't like the fact that always we are dependent whether we can manage from month to month. We don't like our lives at all. Constantly we are fighting with God to change our history. And sometimes Satan puts us against God. He will convince us that God does not love us. He will misinterpret the facts which are taking place in our life to prove to us that this is not a God of love. That if really he was a God of love, then why has he given to me a cancer? If really he was a God of love, then why has he given me a life like this? He will make us compare our life to the life of everybody else and make it appear that the grass is greener on the other side. For this reason, the church, it invites us during this time to use another weapon. And that is the weapon of prayer. Jesus Christ, he had to pray to overcome Satan. He had to pray for 40 days in the desert. He was praying, he was fasting. And how much more we, who are so weak, who need the intervention of God in our life every day. And there is a third temptation. That when Moses, he will go up on top of the mountain to bring down the law of God, to bring down the covenant, the Ten Commandments, the Ten Words of Life. While he is on the mountain for 40 days, the people of Israel, they will turn to the idol. They will make a golden calf. And they will bow down in front of the calf and say, you are the one who has brought us out of Egypt. You are the one who opened the Red Sea. Because they want a God that they can touch. They want a God that they can see. They want a God like all the other people around them have gods that they can carry around with them from place to place. Jesus Christ had to go through the same temptation because Satan will take him on top of a very high mountain, and then from the top of that mountain he will show him all the kingdoms of the earth and say, bow down before me and I will give you the wealth of all these kingdoms, the power and the glory of all these kingdoms. And Jesus Christ will answer him with the first commandment. It is the Lord whom you will serve, the Lord and no other. And we too every day are confronted with this temptation. The temptation to have a God that we can see, a God that we can touch. We are confronted by the idolatry every day. We make everything into an idol. We make our jobs into an idol. We make our children into an idol. We make our career, our education. We think these are the things that can save us. We forget that the one who has given us life, the one who preserves our life, the one who gives us eternal life is our Father who is in heaven, whose name is holy. But we make every object that we see here on this earth, we make it into an idol. We can't bear the fact that we don't have something that we can touch. For this reason, always we want to have a big bank balance. because money is a psychological security. We want to have a nice house, and we want to have another house in the country where we can go for a holiday. Always we want the things which we feel that when we are old and when we become enfeebled, these things we can sell and they can become our security. During this time of Lent, there is another weapon that the church has given to us. The first was the weapon of fasting. The second is prayer. And the third is almsgiving. It is necessary to give, because Jesus Christ himself said, you cannot worship God and money. He didn't say God and education, or he didn't say God and sexuality, he didn't say God and entertainment, but he said God and money, because all the idols are summarized in the security of money. Lent is a time for us to free ourselves from money, so that we can enter really into the providence of God, knowing that he is the one who provides, he is the one who gives, he is the one who is concerned for our life. So I was told to make this video short, so with this I will finish. But keep in mind, my dear friends, these temptations of Christ are not just ordinary temptations, little silly things that we read about. There was bread, go and jump on from the top of the mountain. No, it's not like this game. But these are the temptations that we are going through every day in our life. And Jesus Christ is a man who was tempted in everything that he didn't fall into sin, but he was tempted in everything that we are being tempted with. That is why if Christ lives in me, then even though I am tempted, if he is living in me, I can overcome the temptations. I do not fall in him, because he is the one who was transfigured on Sinai. He is the one who has entered into the glory, and entering into the glory, he takes us with him. After passing through the temptation, he entered into his mission. He entered into the cross, and then he entered into paradise. The people of Israel, after walking 40 years in the desert, after the 40 years are finished, they overcome the seven nations that are occupying the promised land, which signifies the seven capital sins which are living inside of us. And they enter into the promise that God has made for them, into their inheritance. We too, these 40 days, which is a summary of Christian life, the battle of Christian life, at the end of it, there is the promise of the eternal life, which is the feast of the Passover, the Easter, which is waiting for us. Where during this feast of Easter, the church opens the baptismal font, so that in the waters of the baptismal font, we can drown the seven capital sins that are living inside of us. Because baptism means to immerse ourselves, to immerse, to die and to rise again with Christ. Which is the Paschal mystery. I die with Christ and I rise with Christ. So that after Easter, we are able to live in that glorious Paschal time for 50 days, when we wait for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which is the feast of the Pentecost.
At the beginning of the Second Vatican Council, Pope John XXIII led the Church in praying for a fresh outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Renew your wonders in this our day, as by a new Pentecost. A few years later, seemingly as a result of John XXIII's prayer for renewal, a significant event took place that would forever change the lives of millions of Catholics and the Church itself. On a weekend retreat, these Catholic students prayed that, in some way, they too might discover a renewed sense of Pentecost in their lives. Those who prayed for the experience that came to be known as baptism in the Spirit had experiences similar to all the others: a new depth of prayer, love for the Scriptures, a devotion to the Eucharist, a heart for evangelization, a call to conversion, and a life of holiness. On Pentecost Sunday in 1975, Cardinal Sunens and 10,000 individuals who had this charismatic experience met with Pope Paul VI.
We are pleased to see signs of this renewal.
Long life for the charismatics.
Amen! It is my firm hope that the Holy Spirit will find more and more fruitful welcome in the hearts of believers, so that the culture of Pentecost, so necessary in our time, can spread.
We are gathered here, believers from 120 countries in the world, to celebrate the sovereign work of the Holy Spirit in the Church that took the initiative 50 years ago and gave rise to an institution.
No.
An organization?
No. A una corrente di grazia.
To a current of grace.
Alleluia. In February 1972, Catholic Charismatic Renewal began at Mumbai. With those who have experienced the baptism in the Spirit spontaneously during private prayer. Today, Catholic Charismatic Renewal is present in every diocese and state of India. Today, statistically, it is the largest and fastest growing movement in the Catholic Church and is found in all continents and cultures. Priests, religious sisters, and laypersons make it the estimated 120 million who have been influenced by the renewal movement.